Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. I've got another list of names to read, to pray for. Praise God, creator of heaven and earth. Praise God Almighty, King of kings and Lord of lords, who is exalted forevermore. Hallelujah. The Lord is just, I was getting ready to make this video, and the Lord is just speaking to me the song, you know, Great is Thy Faithfulness. The old one, the hymnal song, you know, morning by morning, new mercies I see. And the presence of the Lord is here, and He is highly exalted and worthy to be praised. So let's magnify the Lord God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. Let's lift Him up. Let's lift His name up in this place. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lord God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. Blessed be His name. Hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done in me as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord God Most High. He is worthy. He is worthy of all praise and glory. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, Lord God Almighty, we give You the praise. Blessed be Your holy name, Lord God. And Father, we honor You. We praise You. We worship You. We exalt You, Lord God. Father, we ask You to forgive us of our sins, Lord God. Lord, we have fallen short of Your glory, Lord God. Lord, only You alone are worthy to be praised and exalted, Lord God. Father, we cast down our idols. We cast down our vanities. We cast down everything in our minds, in our vain imagination that has exalted itself against the Word of God. And Father, we just come before Your throne in the name of Jesus, Lord. We bow before You, Lord. For Lord, You said those who humble themselves will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves will be humbled. And Father, we ask You, Lord, for a spirit of wisdom, Lord. And Lord, You said, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. Lord God Almighty, I ask that You give every person listening to this video an ear to hear and an eye to see, and a mouth to speak boldly and declare the salvation of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let freedom ring in the name of Jesus Christ. For Your word says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Hallelujah, Lord. And You said, where sin doth abound, grace doth more abound, Lord God. Hallelujah, Father, for Your grace. For the Lord is good. Hallelujah. Let's sing. In Jesus' name, for the Lord is good and His love endures forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord, God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. All glory and honor to You, Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. No servant is above his master, Jesus said. You know, if they hated me, know they hate you also. It's only good for the servant to be like the master. And this is what the Lord just showed me a few minutes ago while I was in prayer. I saw the Lord. I saw the table was ready for the Last Supper, the marriage supper of the Lamb. And the Lord had that towel in His hands. I said, Lord, you know, what is that? You know, I didn't know what it was. The Lord showed me Himself that He is the servant. Remember in the Word of God how He washed the feet of the disciples? And Jesus said that, you know, you must, if who wants to be, James and John, the two brothers, the sons of Zebedee, their mama was, you know, pushing that they would sit on the Lord's right hand and His left. And then Jesus said, it's not for me to give those positions. You know, it's the Father who gives that. And then He asked them, can you drink the cup that I will drink? And they said, yeah, we can. And the Lord said, yes, you will indeed drink the cup I drink out of. But, you know, those who will be great in heaven will be your servants on earth. And that is the message that the Lord gave for me to give you right now, at this moment, in this hour. God has called you to serve. Now, the problem with most people that go to these, you know, your regular churches, your standard church, that is tradition, not biblical. In the Bible, we see more home churches. All the churches are in homes in the New Testament. There's no commandment. No word given about building buildings, even though, as if you watch my videos, you'll know I've said that if you have enough people, yeah, you need to build a building. It can become a necessity, but not, you know, an elaborate, fancy building. Lots of churches, they'll use the Old Testament stuff from Ezra and all this different stuff, and they'll use those Old Testament texts and use those Bible verses and take it out of context and say, hey, we need to build the temple. When in reality, we are the temple, the Bible says. We are the temple of the living God. We are His temple. Each of us are living stones in the temple of God, and then each one of us within us, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So brothers and sisters, God, as God said in the Old Testament, repeated in Acts chapter 7 and 8 at the sermon of Stephen, He said, you know, God said, I don't dwell in temples. The earth is my footstool. You know, what would you build for me that I would dwell in? You know, we are the house of God. We are the temple of God, not a building, brothers and sisters. So, brothers and sisters, the Lord has called us to be servants, to serve Him, to serve the Master, to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12. And those people that go to the traditional churches, which is not the biblical tradition, but the traditions of man, it goes back, you know, to 200 or 300 AD, coming through Roman Catholicism. This idea of a one-man show, that the pastor is the servant, and then everybody else is just, you know, hanging out, chilling out, and letting the pastor do everything. Now, lots of you guys who are against organized religion, who try to have home churches and stuff, you know, you've got the other extreme of that, you know, where it's, you know, chaos and anarchy, where the Bible says that God is a God of order. You know, He's not a God of confusion, but of peace. So yes, there's order in the church through elders, and some elders are preachers and some elders are not preachers. Anyway, brothers and sisters, we're all called to serve. It's not just the pastor that's supposed to be going and evangelizing and visiting people and praying for people and doing the work of God, but it's the call of all Christians to do the work of God. And that's what I wanted to talk to you about, brothers and sisters. God wants us to serve. Not to be served, but to serve. Now, it's not always true, brothers and sisters. Let me give this a caveat. It's not always true. But I want to tell you guys something that I want you to pray about. There is a sister in Scotland who's been supporting one of the part-time orphans for a long time, for a year or two, whatever, since we started Joshua's ministry, for a year and a half. And she helps. She's given above and beyond the sponsorship of one of these part-time orphans also. Part-time orphans, I mean children of single parents, some of the poor pastors' children and grandchildren and stuff like that, and pastors' children, things like that. She plays the keyboard, and she sings in Christian events sometimes and things like that. And this sister, who doesn't have a whole bunch of money, she sold her keyboard in order to give for us to get a better pots and pans for the, or, you know, a big pot for one of the feeding programs. And she, you know, she gave money to us, and then she gave money to another ministry that feeds homeless people in the United States. Some of you guys know who that is. But that's not important. The thing about it is this sister said to me, just as I always say, and just as the Lord Jesus Christ said, basically, it's easier for the camel to fit through an eye of a needle than a rich man to enter heaven. And no, that's a myth, that there is a gate that goes into Jerusalem that's called the eye of the needle. The eye of the needle. That's not true. That's a made-up story, okay? It's just an urban myth. Number one. Number two, it has nothing to do with the topic we're talking about. Why would people even start talking about that anyway? The point is, it's hard for rich people to get to heaven. Almost impossible. That's the point. Not about camels and needles. It just shows how almost impossible it is to enter the kingdom of heaven. That's why Jesus said, with God, all things are possible. Something I quoted earlier. With man, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. And it's true, brothers and sisters. It's true. I've made several videos and mentioned it. And it's true. Before I came and did my tours of the States, okay, which I'm not really hardly political at all because I'm a pastor and I'm a servant of God. But before I became a pastor, and if I were political, you know, I'm a conservative. I'm between a libertarian and a conservative, okay? I'm for the Constitution and all that stuff, but, you know, on the conservative side. So I've been, you know, not anti, you know, I'm not part of the, you know, Occupy Wall Street and all these communists and socialists and all this stuff. I'm pro people having wealth, and I'm pro those things. Okay, and I'm not envious or against anybody having money. I'm all for that. I'm a capitalist, okay, as much as possible. You know, I'm a libertarian, and let each people earn as much as they can. Let them go for it. Shouldn't have to give none to the government other than a minimal amount for infrastructure and stuff, whatever. But I have come to the conclusion that was the opposite of what I thought before, and I have come to observe that the words of the Lord were true. Of course, I knew that whatever the Lord says is truth. But I've come to personally observe from my experience with Joshua's ministry that the arrogance that I've seen among wealthy people is unbelievable. The selfish, self-indulgent arrogance that I've seen. Now, I know there's lots of poor people that are bad, and that's one reason why they're poor, because they're drunks, they're on drugs, they're lazy, they don't want to work. There's lots of poor people like that, but there are also lots of poor people who are poor from circumstances beyond their control. It's not always stereotypical that people are poor because of their own mistakes, but lots of times that is true, and lots of times it's not. But poor people, you know, they don't have money to give. They don't have enough hardly for themselves, so, you know, they can't hardly give. But I have observed, and it's true, that your average person on the street has the most giving heart. It's the rich people, and then I guess lots of people who are in lots of poverty. They're also selfish, but of course they don't have anything to give if they had it anyway. But this is what I've observed, brothers and sisters. It's a shame. It's a shame that this sister sold her keyboard in order to help Joshua's ministry and I said another ministry in the States. And then there's people. You know, if you, say the average person watching this, if you gave $100, that's a lot of money to you. To some people, if they gave $100,000, it would be like a dollar to the average person. It's really true. I've met people who have that kind of wealth. And of course, we know there's people like Bill Gates and all that kind of stuff. Whatever. There's people that $1 million is like a dollar to the average person. And not that people... If we are a Christian, let's talk about, Bill Gates is not a Christian, he's an atheist or agnostic. Let's talk about Christians. You know, God has called us to serve. And there are lots of times when people, okay, they'll have some other kind of a thing because we have different callings, brothers and sisters, that, you know, if you're a wealthy businessman and you know, lots of people who are wealthy business people, they work like 18 or 20 hours a day. That's how they got wealthy. And that's awesome, and that's a blessing. So they can't go feed the homeless people in Detroit, Michigan. They can't go to the Philippines and build orphanages. But other people can, like myself or other people who are called to do those, you know, the hands-on part of the work of God. There's other people called to that. There are those of you guys who are prayer warriors for Joshua's ministry and other ministries. That's what God called you to do. And that's your service for the Lord. But we need to do the calling of God that's in our lives. And this sister is a great example of someone who's giving up something that they're actually even using for the Lord. And by the grace of God, I want her to get a new keyboard. And I already told her I'd pray about it. And I'm asking you guys, I want to PayPal her the money for her to go buy her another keyboard. Now, that it's not right. She, you know, she's got some disability stuff. Her husband has some disability stuff. And they've got a limited income. And then, you know, it's not right. And I know that people give and then they, you know, she's sowing and then the Lord will bless her and all that. I want the Lord to use Joshua's ministry to be a blessing to her. I ask you guys to help me do that, to replace this sister's keyboard. I don't know what, the original price of her keyboard was. To give her a new keyboard, and I ask you guys to help me do that, brothers and sisters. It's just too much. It's too much. So she gave, and the Lord's going to bless her, and let the Lord use Joshua's ministry to bless her. I ask for your help. I also ask you to contribute if you feel led. It doesn't matter Pastor Dave, who was hung. I didn't see his video. I heard about it. You know, he feeds homeless people up there in Detroit. And, you know, he does a Saturday Sabbath thing. And I don't agree with that doctrine, you know. But the thing about it is, when I've mentioned, like, say, Pastor Dave's name, several people message me and say, well, I don't agree with Pastor Dave's theology. Okay. It has nothing to do with about feeding homeless people in Detroit. And Pastor Dave's theology is within the bounds of Christianity. Just like my doctrine is within the bounds of Christianity. You know, we can agree to disagree about topics. About whether you need to say Yeshua, or if you say, can say, you know, or say Jesus Christ, or if you need to say Yeshua HaMashiach, the Hebrew version. As long as we agree that we can both be Christians, then we're both, you know, and we can accept that as a non-essential doctrine, then we're good to go. And that has nothing to do with, there's lots of people making excuses as to why they don't give. And they're talking, you know, just nitpicking for something because they're just trying to justify themselves. You know, just like Jesus said, you know, they asked Jesus, what's the greatest commandments? And he said, you know, love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And then it says that there was a lawyer there looking to justify himself, said to Jesus, well, just who is my neighbor? You know, well, just who is my neighbor? In other words, does that mean everybody or just my literal neighbor? You know, he's like trying to, you know, milk the system. And then Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan, which is a famous story. So the Samaritans were like the enemies. The relationship between the Samaritans and the Israelites was like between black and white people in the United States pre-1965 or whatever. It's before the Civil Rights Movement. It was that kind of a relationship. Very racist against each other, and they were really like enemies, and they didn't recognize each other as they're both claiming to be the children of God and saying that the other one was not. That's why when Jesus talked to the woman at the well, John chapter 4, kind of the same thing. She was a Samaritan woman. Jesus went to the Samaritans. Anyway, so everyone is our neighbor, and they need our help. And as an example, this sister and Hungs, H-Y-U-N-G, I believe there's an S on there, Pastor Dave. I heard that he made a video, and he's, you know, and there's a huge need for feeding the homeless in Detroit. I know that there's lots of people in Detroit who are homeless because they're on drugs and all that kind of stuff. And obviously the Lord knows that too. But as I made a video a few months ago, as the Lord had given me the revelation, the Lord has some lost sheep. The Lord has some sheep in every category, whether it be homeless, drug addicts in downtown Detroit, whether it be people in Detroit who's lost their home because they lost their job, who are homeless by no fault of their own, who are lost and without hope, but they will get saved through Pastor Dave's ministry. There are people in every walk of life. There's rich people in the United States who will get saved despite the nose on their face. They will get saved despite the bubble they live in by buying, you know, surrounding themselves with yes men. It's just like all these Hollywood movie stars and all that, and all these people like that. They get into so much trouble because they surround themselves with people who are kissing up to them, people that are kissing up to them because of money. And so no one ever says, hey, you need to repent. No one ever says, hey, that's wrong, don't do it. Because people, you know, are afraid of them, or want to kiss up to them. Maybe they'll give them some money, whatever they're thinking, instead of speaking honestly and truthfully with them. And that's why the Lord would allow me to meet these people, because by the grace of God, I'll speak the truth in love to them that no one else has got the guts to say to them. And I praise God for the ministry that the Lord would allow me to speak to people in high places and people in low places. Praise God, wherever they are, God's got sheep everywhere at every level. And we've all been called to be His servants. Now, if you want to be, great in the eyes of the Lord, a lot of people say, well, that false humility, oh, I don't care about rewards. The Lord gave us rewards, and He tells us about rewards in His Word, that Jesus said those who humble themselves will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves will be humbled. Jesus, you know, talks about when you go to a wedding, don't sit at the, you know, the high table at the right, you know, the honored table, because they may ask you to move to a lower table. See, that's the problem with rich people. They want to go sit up there at that honored table. And then later on, they're going to get embarrassed when the Lord says, you know, go wash the feet of the homeless people entering the kingdom of heaven. And they're like a clown at the front door of the heaven washing feet of the poor homeless people from Detroit. You know, it's kind of like the story of rich man and Lazarus. But in the rich man, in that story, he went to hell. I'm talking about Christians losing their rewards. Christians have been in a low place in heaven, because they've exalted themselves, and God has to humble them. You know, they ended up where the homeless man who got saved and got used by God, because whom too much is given, much is required. Those who were given little, of course, God requires less of someone, and that's all they had. In other words, a person with $10 to their name, God can't require them to give $1 million, because that's all they got is $10. Someone with $1 million in their pocket, then they try to give 10. I mean, that's what I've seen. People with millions of dollars trying to give $10 and demanding that you bow down and kiss their foot and be grateful for that. Those people are sadly mistaken. Those people are going to be sadly mistaken on the day when they get up to heaven. They're going to be, you know, this homeless man from Detroit who had $10 to his name and gave away, you know, one or two or five, half of what he had or all that he had to some other homeless person, as the Lord led him, he's going to be sitting on the throne with the Lord, exalted up with the Lord. And then here's, you know, some multi-millionaire dude is going to be down there at the door of heaven washing the feet of people coming in, the other homeless people that made it to heaven. Now that's the way the kingdom of the Lord operates. Go sit, Jesus said, don't go sit at the head table, seat of honor, because you may be asked to move down to a lower seat. Go sit instead at the lowest table. And then the master of the banquet bid thee to move up higher. And then the Lord will exalt you in front of everyone. And the Lord will prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies. God will bless you in the sight of evil. When you humble yourself, he will exalt you. Be a servant unto the Lord. Be a servant, I say. Heed not to the doctrines of men and the doctrines of wealth and riches. For the love of money is the root of all evil. Surrender yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will give you strength. Blessed be the name of the Lord, God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. Hallowed be his name. He is worthy to be praised. He is righteous. He is holy. His judgments are perfect and righteous. Glory to the name of the Lord God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. I speak right now that the Lord would strengthen you in your inner man and lift you up and bless you, not by might nor by power, but by his Spirit. May the grace of the living God be upon you. May his will be done in your life. May you do his will and move forward in the things of God. Serve the Lord today. Store up your riches in heaven, not on earth, where thieves can break in and steal it and moths can destroy it. But store up your riches in heaven, where there are for eternity. For eternity you will have your riches there with the Lord. I just want to tell this. I saw a vision of something and then a joke. There was a man who was about to die. And he said, Lord, I just have one final prayer request. Can you just let me take my gold with me to heaven? Yeah, he was a rich man. But he was a good man. So the Lord granted him his wishes to let him bring his gold to heaven. When he got to heaven, he was carrying his suitcase full of gold. St. Peter met him at the gate, and St. Peter was laughing and said, hey, come here. He called several angels over. Come here and look. Look at this guy. He's got a bag full of pavement. So gold is only payment in heaven. And I had a vision one time about revival. Maybe that's 2007 here in the Philippines. I was praying and fasting for revival with a bunch of Filipino pastors. And I saw these angels coming, and they had wheelbarrows full of gold, and they poured that gold on the ground in my vision, and then they patted it down, and it was like they were like a road crew. They were making a road paved with gold. And then I saw angels coming with trumpets and blasting the trumpets, announcing the arrival of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the, you know, at that time the Lord told me, you know, when a king is coming, in those old days when the king would arrive, you know, there's people running before them, preparing the way. There's people going before them, the king, blowing trumpets and announcing, "Behold, here comes the king, here comes the king." That's a whole nother story. It's a vision that I had. God bless you guys, and know that the streets of heaven are paved with gold. Gold is only pavement in heaven, brothers and sisters. God bless you guys.